Hello folks, this is a short tutorial on how to use a Ledger Nano S with the command line client for Tezos. So in this case, I've cloned the GitLab repository and in particular the betanet branch, which we can check like this. Okay, I'm on betanet. And I've already compiled it so you can see I have my executable files here. And the first thing I'm going to do is run the node. So it's just Tezos node run. And I'm gonna ask it to open in RPC service on the local host. So let's do that, and it's going to find some peers, start some workers on a peer-to-peer layer. There we go. And then it's gonna synchronize. And I've been running this node recently, so it should synchronize pretty quickly. So in the meantime, we can move to another tab where I have a client. So if I run a client, and if you want to have some information on a client, there's some doc at doc.tzalpha.net. But you can also always do Tezos Client Man, which has a lot of colorful information on how to use it. Now you'll notice that every comment I make using Tezos Client is going to start with this disclaimer, which can be a little annoying. So I'll let you in on a little secret, which is that you can set an environment variable to disable that. So I'm going to create my alias. So alias betanet equal, I don't know what he's doing this. Alias betanet equal Tezos client and save disable disclaimer equal yes. And then I call Tezos client on this address and port. Okay. So next, we're going to see if we have any ledgers connected. So I connected a ledger and I added the app from Obsidian, and it's rough around the edges, but it will let you keep your private key inside a secure enclave, which is a lot better than keeping it on your computer. So one comment to do that is betanet. And again, betanet is just an alias I created. So betanet, it's list connected ledgers, because you could have more than one. So it shows me this ledger. And it's gonna. There's a path to access it, and what you see here is a public key hash of the root key. So keys inside Ledger Nanos are stored as they're hierarchical keys. So you have a root at the of the tree, and that's just how we refer to it. But just because I'm picking a key on that ledger does not mean that it corresponds to that. That's the root key, and in fact you can have many paths inside of the ledger. So one thing I can do is betanet show ledger pass, and then, for example, try this one. So this is a pass 00, meaning I'm taking the branch 0 and the branch 0. And the app will ask me to sign. It's not strictly necessary to sign here. It's just a check that the software is running to make sure that you can actually make a successful signature with that key. So I'll agree to sign. And at this pass, I see you have a completely different address. So you have an near infinity of addresses you could build this way. So let's just extract one, and I'm gonna call, so let's look at this one. Okay, I like it, I'm gonna call that one Bob. And so in order to do that, I need to import a secret key. Now, obviously I'm not really importing the secret key because I can't extract it from the Ledger Nano, that's the entire point. But what the client is going to know is that, you know, somehow I can use that secret key. I can make signatures with it. So it's kind of storing a pointer to it. So import secret key. I'm going to give it a name, say Bob, and on this ledger. Okay, there we go. I added this address. All right. So let's see if there's a balance for Bob. So get balance for Bob. And Bob has 0 tizzies, of course, because the key was just created. However, Bob has a friend named Alice, and Alice has 1 tizz. Okay, so let's do a transfer. And maybe I don't remember exactly how to make a transfer. So I'm gonna do a betanet man transfer, get some sense. Okay, transfer a quantity from source to destination, and I can pass a fee, I can do a dry run. And if I want to be more sophisticated, I could pass a gas limit, a storage limit, some arguments if I'm calling a smart contract, and queue, which is to get some more debug information. So I don't want most of that. I'm just going to do validate transfer one from Alice to Bob. Let's just pass this no fee. And we're going to do a dry run just to see what happens. Okay, so it's not really going to add any bytes. So it's not going to charge me any storage costs. It's going to take relatively little gas. The ledger is asking me to sign. It's not actually displaying the transactions yet. That's in the pipeline. It's obviously important, but it's still beneficial to have your keys on a hardware device. So I'll sign it, and here's what it's going to look like. So at the end, you'll have this balance updates where Alice is going to be short. You're going to lose one Tez, and Bob is going to gain one Tez. So let's do it for real. And so again, I'll sign this transaction, and it's going to be injected in a node. That'll take a little while. Okay, it's done. And so just because it's been included, of course, doesn't mean it's safe to rely on it if you're receiving a payment. Obviously, for one Tez, it's not a big amount, so you don't really need to wait. But you have an option here to wait with like setting a number of confirmation. There's a more principled way of checking if a transaction has been successfully confirmed, which is based on counting the number of endorsements. For now, as a very conservative rule of thumb, we're suggesting 30 confirmations, mostly because people are used to waiting for 30 minutes. Based on the properties of the algorithm, it's probably very conservative, but you know, would rather be safe than sorry for now. So let's check the balance again. So betanet get balance for Alice and get balance for Bob. And that's it, we've made a transfer and it's all on a ledger key for Bob. All right, thank you very much. And in another update, I'll show how to use a command line to deploy a smart contract and send data to it. Thank you.